Well, obviously, there's a lot of different types of traders out there, and our guest today is a contrarian trader. We're going to talk to him about what that means. Tony Drager, thanks very much for being here, Tony.
My pleasure, Tip.
Well, when you say a contrarian trader, what do you mean by that?
Well, I look for areas in the market that might be too expensive or too cheap. You know, so when they talk about the trend is your friend, that's fine until it isn't. Then what do? Not trade. So I look by a comparing contrasting model. When price moves into areas that might be too expensive or too cheap. You don't want to buy anything expensive. You don't want to sell and get short anything too cheap. And so essentially I'm looking to sell off of highs and buy off of lows with the idea of managing my risk and knowing where all my exits are before my entries.
So how do you avoid trying to pick tops and bottoms before they're confirmed or whatnot and getting caught in something you don't want to be in?
It's valuing price for me. It's like, you know, I strip out in my trading gold, the price of gold, the price of oil, the price of S&P. Really, it's the same thing. It's the price, and that's what you have to worry about. How do you value price? So the same way, from a practicality standpoint, we value price in the real world. You look and measure different houses in a neighborhood to find value, different dealerships that sell cars to find value. So if you're a gold trader and you don't know what the price of silver is doing, you're missing something. You're missing something that's essential to find value as to, is one a little oversold and cheapening up, and the other one showing a little strength within the same, what I call a complex. So I don't try to get in front of trades or trains to buy lows and sell highs. I'm just looking for value where a market might be a little overextended. Because let's face it, that's what markets do most of the time. They rotate within a range. They make higher highs, lower lows, and then come back. And when we do have a trend, when I do have and see there might be a trend that the prices are going to stay intact and continue rallying throughout a session, I have a filter. So I indeed don't step in front of that train and start turning a fading strategy into a fighting strategy.
So, Tony, can you give us an example of a trade where you did this recently?
Well, in fact, not too long ago, we had the NASDAQ and the Dow making higher highs on the session. So they made day session highs, they came off, retested those highs successfully, but the S&P just couldn't quite get to those relative highs. And so that was starting to show me that possibly the NASDAQ and Dow were overbought and getting expensive, and the S&Ps were weakening up. So by that simple, you know, comparing and contrasting technique, I have an execution style where I don't just get in and sell, because the S&Ps could catch up and make higher highs. But let the market come off, sell it, identify my risk, and know where I'm going to get out for losers. That identifies where my rewards are going to be. And so, you know, the market starts to move my way. And I also have a time element where if I'm in the trade too long, I'll get out wherever it is. Because, again, you got to remember, if you're selling near highs or buying near lows, the longer you're closer to that level, the better chance it has of going back through it. So if I'm fading, I want to make sure, yeah, I'm looking for these things to pull back in this example and get deceleration in price. But if I don't get it within a certain time frame, I'm out for either a small winner, small loser, or a break even.
All right, so the Dow and the NASDAQ were doing something. The S&P wasn't quite acting the same, so you saw an opportunity in the S&P. How do you decide then what your profit target's going to be and what your risk is going to be?
Well, it's like this. If you're selling it and trying to keep it practical, if you're selling it because you think the highs are in temporarily and those highs get taken out, that's around the area you have to be proven wrong. So it's usually right around new highs. So if the S&Ps were to, in fact, make higher highs on that session, I'd be out for a loser. So depending on where I get in to where those highs are would be where I would say that's my risk. So I know all this before I get in the trade. I know if it fits within my risk appetite. I know what my loser is going to be when I'm wrong. I strip out the element of surprise. And then by knowing how much my losers are going to be, I then look to take bigger winners. If it's 2-1, 3-1, or not quite that, usually 2-1, 1.5-1 is within the realm of what you could expect the market to do. If you're starting to look for 2-1, 3-1 trades, you're probably asking too much for a market to move in that direction. But the whole strategy keeps me from, again, not being surprised if I take a loser, and it gives me healthy profit targets and keeps my average winners bigger than my average losers.
Tony, thanks for your time.
My pleasure, Tim.